It is easy to feel like a certain type of PC RPGs are in a bit of a weird spot right now. The Fallout franchise is in a bit of a thought area, so a lot of people were placing their hopes in Obsidian, legendary developer of Fallout New Vegas, who were working on their own original RPG IP in the form of The Outer Worlds. And holy guacamole, they actually pulled this off! I bought this game on Saturday, I started writing this video on Sunday night, and by that point I played over 30 hours of this game in a single weekend. It's Fallout
in space!
With a bit of Mass Effect mechanics on it. If you like that sort of RPG, you absolutely have to play this game. But will you be able to run it? Outer Worlds has minimum requirements that are more or less in line with most of the games released this year. If you're trying it on, say, a Ryzen APU powered PC, it actually does quite well on lower settings and a lower resolution scale. But what if you are under that? What if you're a tad behind the curve and want to try this under the minimum requirements? Or you have a decent PC or console stashed somewhere but you're just curious at what lies under the hood? No problem, everyone's welcome. Since this is a pretty standard Unreal Engine 4 game, there's a couple of quick adjustments that you can do to increase performance even after lowering all the settings to the minimum, at the cost of some visual fidelity. Or just straight up break the game. Welcome to the LowSpecGamer, let's get right to it. The configuration files for Outer Worlds are located in a folder called Indiana in the hidden local app data folder. I will leave the full path on the screen if you want to access this yourself. Game user settings is usually the main configuration file that stores whatever you set on the configuration screen. The real magic is the empty scalability.ini, which can be loaded with some general Unreal Engine 5 commands that will be read by the game. I have left a link in the description for the standard scalability.ini that I have used on previous Unreal Engine 4 videos, but let me walk you through the three variables that actually do most of the work. If you're looking for a quick FPS fix, add the shadow quality section of the file to disable shadows, granting you an important boost in FPS at the cost of some fidelity. This is because this game uses shadows extensively to keep some of the cooler areas their distinct mood, and you will definitely be screwing up with that, but it is not terrible. Here's another minor change. The game seems to be applying some level of anti-aliasing at all time, which is particularly noticeable when turning the resolution scale down, a very common setting for modern games on integrated GPUs. If you find this annoying, the post-process quality part of the file will disable anti-aliasing for a very small boost. Also, kudos to Obsidian for leaving the render resolution scaler almost unlocked and available for some really low values. Those changes will do 90% of the work you will see on this video, so if FPS is all you're here for, you can leave it at that. But you're not here for that only, are you? You saw the thumbnail, you know there's more. Fine, here we go. The texture quality section of scalability, and in particular, the mipmap LOD bias line, can be used to absolutely destroy this game's textures. The higher the value, the worse it gets, and at 15, characters lose all hair, and the world gets reduced to this. Now, this is absolutely some people's aesthetic, and if you want to run the whole game like this, power to you. Just expect some bugs reading certain elements in the game. The good news is that if you're using a lower number, you can still affect textures without having to resort to those extremes. Drop it to say 5 or 4, and characters at least have their hair back and the world as a whole becomes more tolerable. While this is very flashy and makes for great thumbnail material, make sure you're only doing this if you need so. In my experience, this sort of texture trick is useful for VRAM bandwidth issues, which tend to be the case on integrated GPUs that have to use RAM as VRAM, or ultra-low memory conditions. But you might not have to get to those extremes. I will leave the value at 5, shadows disabled, and no anti-aliasing to run an actual test. For my test, I will be running this on a mini PC with an Athlon 200ge with 8 GB of DDR4 RAM at 2666 MHz. I use the Athlon 200ge often on this channel since it is powerful enough for a lot of lighter titles and a great overall entry-level CPU, but its integrated GPU can struggle a bit with newer games. Outer Worlds is not an exception. On 1080p, but the resolution scale set to 40%, so a practical render resolution of 768x532, upscaled on most outdoor scenes, the game is a bit away from hitting the 30fps it so surely deserves. Apply our custom scalability.ini, and boom, 30fps at least. Again, removing shadows and anti-aliasing is doing most of the heavy lifting for this specific setup, but this might be just enough to get the game working. Performance on any indoors scene is evidently going to be much better, but your mileage in terms of how much tweaking the graphics will help you will vary. Now, is the game actually playable? Happily, that does seem to be the case. I took this PC for a spin on a couple of combat scenarios outdoors and indoors, and while there's obvious drops, they never quite got to the point of unplayability. Not bad for such a humble component. Now with this knowledge, you can hopefully customize this configuration file depending on how much you're willing to sacrifice and get this game working on a more modest PC, or at least appreciate some of the weird directions a modern game like this can take. Either way, you can get back to immersing yourself in this universe where corporations and their interests own everything. They own all the data, and when corporations make mistakes, you end up paying the price while they just cover it up. Or you could stop staring at the real world in your window and go play a video game. Now, next time one of those corporations that owns all your data makes a mistake and leaks all your passwords online and they try to cover it up, you can at least be safe from collateral damage by using Dashlane, this video's sponsor. Dashlane is a suite of security software that helps keep you safe in the online world. It has a VPN that keeps which websites you visit a secret or allows you to access region-locked content. It also helps generate unique, safe passwords for all your accounts and keep them locally encrypted with just one master password. Every time one of these leaks happen, hackers will try to use the passwords and emails that leaked on every service possible to access your sensitive accounts. This tends to work because passwords are hard to remember, so people reuse the same one everywhere. Heck, this is almost how I lost my Twitter account. With Dashlane password storage, you only have to remember one password while remaining secure. And even if your password storage gets compromised, the local encryption means everything is safe as long as the master password is kept secret. And it has dark web monitoring, which checks if any of your passwords are in major leaks and alerts you to immediately change your password before it's too late, which has saved me twice already. The good news is that dashlane.com/lowspecgamer will give you a 30-day free trial so you can see this for yourself. And if you use the code LowSpecGamer at checkout, you can get a 10% off your annual subscription, which is actually a very small price to pay for peace of mind. This is a service that I use, without an exaggeration, every day, and it makes my life so less anxious, so I definitely recommend it. Thank you to them for sponsoring this video, and you for watching.